the 6th edition of Financial Security Conclave 2024, also known as FinSec 2024. And just so that everybody in the room and outside, of course, knows that we've gotten these sessions and this stage started, can you all please help me out here by putting your hands together in a big round of applause? All right, so I think this applause sounds good to me. But looking at all of you in the audience, I think you all can still do it better because the best is yet to come. So once again, let me take it from the top and let me hit the rewind button and repeat that one more time. I welcome you all to the 6th edition of Financial Security Conclave, also known as FinSec 2024. Can we have the loudest round of applause, please? Thank you so much. So while I still see some conversations happening in the room right now, but I love that even though I'm requesting everyone, it's almost hard to break certain conversations, which is actually great, because it sort of mirrors of what is happening outside in the industry. It is the buzz. So thank you so much for bringing that buzz, for bringing the conversations to this conclave. Well, I am Priya Shramankar, your host for today. And once again, on behalf of DSCI, I humbly extend my warmest reception to each one of you, ladies and gentlemen, to our esteemed delegates, our partners, our sponsors, our delegates and exhibitors to this conclave. That being said, ladies and gentlemen, one more time, can we have a big round of applause before we begin with our sessions? Thank you so much. And now, before we begin, let me actually go there and be to a place where I truly, truly belong. Ladies and gentlemen, well, today is a big day as the nation gets to know the mandate of the citizens where we assemble here to discuss the future of financial security, to keep the country safe, secure our technologies, and position as a global leader in cybersecurity. Well, that being said, this year's conclave marks a significant milestone as we gather here to explore the dynamic growth of financial security in an increasingly digital world with emerging technologies, cybersecurity solutions, and privacy compliance. Well, Data Security Council of India has been collaborating with esteemed banking and financial service institutions for several years. And as the financial sector continues to embrace digitization and face sophisticated cyber threats, the need for a unified platform where leaders from the BFSI industry can convene has become paramount. Well, that being said, over the next 2 days, ladies and gentlemen, FinSec 2024 will feature over 70 plus speakers and 30 sessions. Well, these sessions will delve into some very, very crucial subjects. We have some wide area of subjects to be discussed here, such as payments ecosystem advancements, open banking and open finance, ransomware resilience, modernization of security operations. Well, we also reserve some time for some very crucial segments, focusing on AI-fueled financial services landscape, data centrality of protection, trust, and ethics. Well, we also will delve into digitization of transaction processing, the future of mobile security. We'll also talk about ESG adoption and sustainable finance, to fraud response management, and more. And we hope, and not hope, but I'm in fact sure that you all will gain invaluable insights from these conclaves and leverage that extensive knowledge shared during this event. Well, we also have some very interesting hashtags for this conclave, which is hashtag FinSec 2024. So I would urge everyone to share your key takeaways, all that you get to experience on this platform, on your social media handles. And I'm sure that the online community is waiting to know of all the action that will be happening right here at this conclave. So it's hashtag FinSec 2024. And do not forget to tag us at DSCI. And if you are sharing all these insights on your social media handles like Twitter or LinkedIn or X, do tag us at DSCI_connect. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's time once again. We are here at FinSec 2024, powered by Palo Alto Networks, and we look forward to an engaging and productive conclave. Also, ladies and gentlemen, please note that post the inaugural, our national COE Innovation Arcade will be inaugurated sharp at 11:30 a.m. at the Powai Ballroom, where you can experience the engagement from 18 premier startups and exhibitors. And also to add to it that we have a special funding announcement that will be made, so please take a note of it as well. Again, a humble request to each one of you to please keep your cell phones on the silent mode to avoid any disturbances to the proceedings of the day. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time. The time has arrived to officially inaugurate FinSec 2024, and we are deeply honored and humbled to host this esteemed conclave in the financial capital of India. Well, today, we have the distinct pleasure of being joined by our chief guest, Ms. Ruma De, DMD and Group Compliance Officer, SBI, to officially inaugurate the event. And joining her on stage is Mr. Vinayak Godse, CEO, DSCI. So can we welcome both of them with a big round of applause, please. Warm welcome. I'd urge you all to please take your seats. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is firstly time to invite Mr. Godse right here at the podium to deliver his welcome address, and who, of course, has been at the forefront of leading meaningful conversations and bringing all of you together. Can we have a round of applause for Mr. Vinayak Godse?
This is a sixth version of Financial Security Conclave that we do. We call this a FinSec Conclave. We started 6 years back putting together, because we know cybersecurity overall impacts almost every sector. If you talk about digitization of the country, we have largely four things, right? One is that every sector, despite financial sector, technology sector, is digitizing. Secondly, the kind of transaction processing industry and the revolution that we have seen in last so many years, especially after 2016, right? And digital payment industry, because of those digital public infrastructure initiative of the government of India, and more importantly, because of the financial sector, the way they have innovated. So that's the second segment of digitization. Third is certainly the emerging tech that we talk about, right? The way the emerging technology is evolving, and we are adopting basically, and how that is paving the way for the digitization and more technology advancement. And the last part is the critical sector. Even defense sector is digitizing in this country quite significantly. So the digitization story or digital economy of the country is largely these four areas basically. And then we have looked at as overall globally look at the digitization and innovation agenda basically, right? There are largely until now three narrations, right? One is certainly US, which is led by the private sector. China, which is led by state intervention, state doing a lot of things there basically. Europe is largely led by something as a human rights-centric approach to digitization. And we know that every regulations of data or now AI as well is coming from Europe. And our digitization is very interesting, basically. We looked at the architectures. We looked at those interventions. And that's why we call it digital public interfaces, basically. And because of those architectures, we made it so participative, so democratized, that the entire ecosystem of digitization that globe look at, so we process almost 120, 130 billion number of transactions in a year. And the kind of a scale that we achieved, right? And kind of inclusion that we achieved, basically. Very small transaction. The paradigm has changed, digitization paradigm has changed from the high value, low volume to low value, high volume game, basically. And this intervention has happened because of all the ecosystem work together with this architecture we put together, started with UIDA, then UPI. Now we are trying to replicate many other such kind of thing in other areas as well. So the transaction processing industry, especially the industry which processes the transaction, has seen quite a significant evolutions and very aggressive digitization that we have seen, right? And the kind of each of us have been doing transaction quite intensely, right? And when we look at that, and when we see until now what had happened, and we still see that this is a very early stage of digitization, basically. A lot of things would happen. We are making plans for the next phase of digitization in this country. We are talking about where will the UPI next will go. Aadhaar is talking about where the Aadhaar 2.0 would be going, basically. So means we are still at a curves of the situation where things will be significantly scaled up in coming future, basically. And with this scale up, basically, so the entire transaction processing industry or BFSI sector that we talk about, so what is the context, basically? So we know the regulatory ecosystem is quite active in this, especially RBI, because of that cybersecurity ecosystem in banking sector looks very advanced and mature. And now other sectors are also capturing very much to RBI, like capital sector, like insurance sector. And the regulatory ecosystem is definitely one important part, but this also poses a lot of challenges for the banking organization, regulated entities, basically, in terms of how you manage that. And we really thank, ma'am, for you being here. And despite taking care of overall SBI, you have been taking care of the overall compliance and that too very significant compliance ecosystem that was you all. And with your presence, basically, I'm really happy that we are inaugurating this financial security conclave. So the overall agenda is really, we almost 30 to 40 different sessions talking about some of the thing that we are doing now, something that will happen from now, basically, something which is very distant to us. In the morning, we had a session on a Web 5.0, for that matter. Some of the thing which is very national in center. For example, we are doing one session tomorrow as a geopolitics and payment, basically. So what are those interactions happening, right? We have perspective, national perspective, industry perspective, transaction perspective, technology perspective, and all of those things is an ecosystem, right? And when we largely at as a country level, we talk about overall cybersecurity, but when it comes to financial sector, we talk about, in this particular session, largely every discussion happens around the how exactly financial ecosystem is evolving and what we are doing to take care of security and, more importantly, privacy nowadays as well, right? And as DPDP Act is there, and we will see the enforcement of that act in coming after this result, we will see a lot of those implementation happening from the privacy, and a lot of those commitments has to be made for the privacy, basically, right? So when this this financial security conclave, we devised the agenda for this, we could take quite a significant input from the entire community that we engage with in banking sector, in insurance sector, many other sectors, basically. Based on those inputs, we put together this agenda. So this 2 days agenda, which have master classes, keynote sessions, parallel track sessions. We are doing a specific kind of track on innovation as well. So we must be doing a lot of technology players here, and there is also startup arena that we have created. We'll request you to visit those the expo that has been devised for technology players as well as the startup ecosystem that we created, and then just 2 days of interactions and engagement. So this conclave and overall the ACS event that we do is largely a very dialogue-based engagement, basically. So we are not here to preach from the ACS. We are here to listen from you, get people to together and deliberate and discuss about the challenges that we are facing now and challenges we'll be facing after now. Some of the good ideas, that the good practices that we have implemented, some of the new innovation which is happening in this field, basically. So these 2 days will be very engaging 2 days, and I'll assure from the DSA team perspective and overall ecosystem perspective, very engaging, enriching kind of interactions we'll see in the coming 2 days of time. And there are a lot of features that that are meant for a particular segment of the population of coming here. For example, somebody is interested in a technology, somebody is interested in best practices, somebody is interested in future, which is happening. So all of those things have been put together by the ACI team with help and input from the financial sector ecosystem that we work together. And we know that today is really a day critical for all of us. And today is also the result day, and still we see room full of people, right? And really thank you all for joining us here for this financial equity conclave. Thank you, ma'am, for being with us for this inaugural function. With this, welcoming you all from the ACI team and overall ecosystem, and with all the partners and providers here, including Palo Alto and many other partners which are helping us, welcoming all to these 2 days of a very engaging and enriching discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Godse, for that address and for your enlightening words. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for another inaugural address for the day. And we today have with us our honorable chief guest, well, who is the Deputy Managing Director and Group Compliance Officer at SBI, overseeing compliance for 26 entities within the SBI financial conglomerates. Armed with a rich experience of over 31 years now, she has held various positions, including including General Manager in Kerala from 2018 to 2020, to Chief General Manager of Bhubaneswar Circle 2020 to 2021, and the first female Chief General Manager of Kolkata Circle. Well, her expertise spans credit and risk management to retail banking and human resources, also adding is agricultural banking, international banking, and compliance. Ladies and gentlemen, with a huge round of applause, let's welcome Ms. Ruma Day, DMD and Group Compliance Officer, SBI. Warm welcome to you, ma'am.
So, namaste and a very warm good morning. Namaste and a warm good morning. नमस्ते कोई हम बोलते नहीं हैं, पर मोदी जी तो कहते हैं, पर आप लोग नहीं कहते हो. दैट इज जस्ट टू ब्रेक द आइस. सो वंस अगेन वेरी वार्म गुड मॉर्निंग. इन फैक्ट आई वॉज टेलिंग सर, व्हेन यू नो मैडम वॉज मेकिंग द अनाउंसमेंट्स टू कम इनसाइड, यू हैव मेड द आउटसाइड सो अट्रैक्टिव दैट यू नो पीपल आर नॉट विलिंग टू कम एंड सिट इनसाइड. सो अनलेस माई यू नो योर टॉक एंड माई टॉक इज सफिशिएंटली इंटरेस्टिंग, we will not be able to hold these people inside. So I will not take much time, maybe 15 or 20 minutes, some thoughts which I have put together for this morning. And it was I felt very energized to see a very, very invigorating environment outside when I landed. And, you know, when I walked in till there, I said, okay, maybe, you know, in a sari, I was wondering, I am completely out of place. Everyone is in suits. So I told Sukrit, he said, no, ma'am. And then I found, okay, there were some of us in saris. Of course, it doesn't matter whether you are in a sari or a suit. The issue is how we take this forward. Vinayakji, thank you. And I must congratulate on the very contemporary logo that you have designed. So I think you would have selected this logo. I think this logo deserves a big round of applause. It is very, 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 very thematic, very contemporary. And if you see it going around here in this podium, you'll feel mesmerized by the way it is going around. So my compliments, Vinayakji. Yeah, let me begin with a news item of in the Times of India last week. The first 4 months of 2024, they have seen 7,000 online complaints per day. Investment scams, sextortion, and other frauds where Indians lost 1,750 crores of rupees. Over 7,40,000 cybercrime complaints lodged on the National Crime Cyber Reporting Portal. 7,40,000, can you imagine? 2.2 billion lost in more than 62,000 complaints of investment scams, lure of easy money. I'm sure all of you who are present here would have received innocuous looking and fraudulent fake SMSs, WhatsApp messages, emails, and telephone calls at some time or the other. Any victims here? There goes hand. Anyone else? There goes another hand. There goes another hand. All of you are in the same field. Despite that, you know, you are falling prey to this, these messages. In these cases, individuals are targeted through social engineering, phishing, lure of easy money, high returns on investment. Who doesn't want money? And defrauded in a click. You click on a fraudulent link or open a phishing email. And I know many, you know, many very senior officials, educated, very, very high-ranking officials clicking on phishing mails. It's a common exercise which is carried out in most organizations, and people fall prey to it. And once you click on this, your money is stolen in your account in a matter of few minutes, your money is gone, aided by the speed of the digital transactions. In some social engineering frauds, individuals are lured into scams through successful psychological maneuvering spread over maybe a few days or a few weeks. And over this time, people have given their money away in installments to these people, to the fraudsters. The latest, what I hear, is the digital arrest. How many of you had heard of this? Digital arrest? Yeah, I see some hands going up. Where this person was told that you are under digital arrest, you have been found guilty of, doing terrorism activities or, for drugs. Drugs have been sent in your name. It bears your Aadhaar number. It bears your address, everything. And you are under arrest. I am a police officer. This is what is happening in the country now. These are with individuals. Similarly, organizations and institutions, they are also increasingly getting susceptible to technology risk and cybersecurity attacks. All of you are aware, November 22, AIIMS faced two attacks in November 22. November 22 and June 23. What happened? November 22 attacks, they caused massive disruption in the services. Their servers were down. The hospital had to fall back on the manual processes to treat their patients. Doctors could not access their prescriptions, what they had already prescribed. They could not access the case histories of the patients. You can imagine what a massive disruption it was. Massive patient inconvenience, massive inconvenience to the doctors also, because they have to only rely on their memory. Case patient ko kya diya tha? The second attack in June 2023 was successfully thwarted due to the coordinated activity between all the stakeholders. So it's not that we cannot combat. We require that constant vigil, we require that constant monitoring and coordinated action with all the stakeholders, be it public, private, government, everything. Similarly, ICMR site has targeted 6,000 times by the hackers. So the continuously they are going on trying to hack the system just like a woodpecker hacks on the bark of the tree. They will not let up. So that constant vigil is very, very important. Ransomware attacks have targeted many organizations, leading to substantial financial losses and reputational damage. In the country, 79 million cyber attacks have been done in 2023. And in 2023, India was ranked as the third largest country globally for phishing attacks. The financial service sector is a prime sitting target. And obviously, it witnessed the highest number of phishing attempts in 2023, as well as the significant increase in the number of phishing attacks. It went up by 400%, almost. Now, the financial services sector, it is the custodian of the customer's trust. And the most important thing, customers, public money, we are dealing with public money. And not only that, we are the most important pillar in the Indian economy, in any country's economy for that matter. And it is most crucial that the entire ecosystem of this sector, we come together to battle this increased menace of cybersecurity risk and cyber frauds. In India, the spectacular rise of the digital payment infrastructure, DPI space, which Sir referred to, it is highly complemented across the world. People right at the grassroots are able to access with their thumb, with their mobile. They are able to access digital payments, they are able to make digital, online digital transactions at the click of a button. Ever-increasing internet access and connectivity, extensive use of this financial transactions payment space by both urban and rural users, this has increased the susceptibility of the financial sector, and it will fall prey to the cybersecurity risks, and fraudsters are having a gala time. The more we are opening up, the more we are making ourselves susceptible to risk. So how do we build our safeguards? Today, cybersecurity risk is identified as one of the most critical risks facing the financial services sector. And given the sensitive characteristic of financial data that we are having, high potential of this data to be disrupting the financial economy of the country, The discussions are on cybersecurity risk are no longer restricted to the IT center or the people involved in the IT design or the IT infrastructure. It is now getting the attention at all boardrooms. Cybersecurity risk is being focused on in a very, very big manner. The top management and the board of directors are keenly monitoring what is happening in the cybersecurity risk, how we are mitigating, and along with that, with the introduction of the DPDP Act in July 2023, both the issues, cybersecurity and data protection, are getting the attention of the board, because we have to keep the trust of the customers intact in the financial system and in their propensity to save with the bank. The risks of data breaches, when fraudsters may get access to sensitive financial data, either through hacking systems of the principal organization or through any of the third-party service providers. This must be countered with strong fence guards, as user access management, data encryption for data in transit and data at rest, the multi-factor authorization, updation of the security and antivirus patches in a regular manner, and at all the endpoints. The challenge is, you know, I come from a very big organization, huge number of endpoints. The challenge is, how do you maintain this endpoint security at these data points? For us, it is not only the technological part of it, but it is also part of how do we align the mindset of our people, of our internal people, to understand what are the risks they are running. Similarly, the social engineering and phishing frauds, they need customer education. So a lot of initiatives are taken, please do digital, take care. But an element of caution definitely needs to be incorporated in every message that we sent out. And how to prevent and what is the redressal? So as a bank, we normally come out with this, this is what you can use it for. In case, please exercise caution. These are the preventive measures, how you exercise caution. And then lastly, if anything, God forbid, happens to you, how do you redress your grievance? Where do you go for a grievance redressal? Similarly, setting up of threshold limits. So in our bank, we have, the system where we can set limits. I can set limits for my credit card or debit card, saying that this is what I will allow in POS transaction. If I don't need to use it in POS, I say, well, I don't want in POS, I want only in online. Or I don't want online, I want only in POS. This is the limit I set for my ATM card, so that we build our own fence guards, depending on our individual risk appetite. This education has to pass down to the consumers. Even though we are giving on our website and all that these facilities are available, people have very less time to read. So therefore, most of the customers land up without having knowledge about these. So the more we spread, the more we make it, capsules, reels. If we can make some reels on this, perhaps, people will look at it and do it. Another critical factor is to combat security risk is to have in place the right policy frameworks for organizations like us, regular risk assessments, and to identify vulnerabilities and adopt the appropriate mitigation strategies. The challenge is, how do you have a constant vigil? 24/7, 365, 24/7, monitoring the threat landscape, and how do we adapt to these emerging risks? Ability to catch the risk as soon as it is coming up, and to detect and anticipate how the risk will play out. That is the key to being very, very proactive. The organizations which have these regular risk assessments, security audits happening regularly, vulnerability assessments, penetration testing, they are better equipped to handle the cybersecurity risks which are present now and are ever increasing going forward. Coming to technology, the entire financial services, all of you are aware, backbone is technology. We are more a tech-fin company than a bank. Everything is based on technology. So while technology gives ease of business, there are some inherent risks which can disrupt the business. The DDoS attacks, they disrupt online services, put customers to inconvenience, downtime of the channels, of the applications go down, the regulator comes down very heavily on us. So it leads to financial losses, leads to losses in reputation. The moment, you know, internet banking is down or your YONO is down, people will start posting on the Instagram, on Twitter or X as it is called. You know, the system is down, the bank is gone for lunch. Although that does not apply. In the physical context, SBI people have gone for lunch. That is the, buzzword for quite some time now. The ransomware attacks, they lock the critical systems and are very, very detrimental to the services being provided. The risk mitigation, some measures, robust user access management, restricting user access through the principle of least privilege, rigorous monitoring of the network for anomalies, maintenance of a regular data backup, implementation of robust endpoint protection and endpoint security plans, and effective establishment of incident reporting mechanisms. These are of immense practical use for all organizations. And in many of these cases, the third-party service providers are able to provide us with solutions. This leads to the critical factor of business and operational resilience. What is the RTO? What is the RPO? What is the role of each of the stakeholders once an incident is reported? Defining these and disseminating this within the organization are very critical, and it will help big organizations like us and even small organizations to define and align with the business risk appetite. So we need to have a well-defined tolerance limits, a well-defined risk assessment framework, and risk management mechanisms, not only for the business risk, but also for technology risks and associated cyber risks. As a nation, various initiatives have been taken by the Government of India to combat this menace of cyber frauds and enhance the cyber security. CERTIN, all of you must be aware of CERTIN. It plays a vital role in controlling cybersecurity incidents and coordinating the cybersecurity incident response activities. In the AIIMS incident, CERTIN played a very, very crucial and critical role as a stakeholder in mitigating the effects of the attack and preventing the second attack. The National Cybersecurity Policy is a crucial initiative of the Government of India. And it is to combat the cyber threats and create a secure cyber ecosystem with the aim to protect information as well as other critical infrastructure. The Data Security Council of India has played a crucial role in furthering the initiatives of the government. This is the sixth edition of the FinSec Conclave, bringing together the leaders, the practitioners, the policymakers, researchers, and innovators, calling upon their expertise and experience to examine the key trends and developments and laying the roadmap for cybersecurity, data privacy for the financial services sector. Many of the themes I was going through, ransomware resilience, generative AI to augment cyber defense, data protection compliance, all of you know the DPDPA rules are expected anytime soon. In fact, MIT has gone on record saying that within the next 100 days, it will come out with the rules, and the time has already started. The ESG adoption, links between climate risks and cyber risks, thinking beyond authentication and authorization. How do we protect? Right now, most of our systems have this OTP and multi-factor authentication. Can we think beyond this OTP and multi-factor authentication to protect our customers, protect our systems? METI of this Government of India, I think they are also conducting some sessions on this data prevention, the DPDP Act. And since the countdown has started, it may very well be a moment, you know, Y2K moment for the financial services sector. Not only do we have to, you know, enhance our systems, how we are interacting with customers, how our staff are interacting with customers, what do staff perceive about data privacy, everything will be undergoing a sharp transformation. So in addition to customer education, in addition to the staff education, all of us present in this room, since we are aware, we all need to first equip ourselves with the tenets of the policy, as well as also start practicing it. Now, some of you, most of you would have stayed in a, you know, hotel any time, and they ask you for your Aadhaar card. How many of you have shared your Aadhaar card? I think all of us would have shared our Aadhaar card. Do we know what they have? What do they do with that Aadhaar card? We don't know. We don't write and tell them that, look, this is only for the purpose of gaining entry into the hotel or getting booking a hotel room. You are not authorized to use it for any other purpose. We tend to give our personal data very, very freely. You go to your friend's house, the watchman there will take your photograph. He'll ask you for your mobile number. He'll ask you for your name. Still now they don't ask for Aadhaar card, but you know it can come anytime. So all these three things you have given him, very, very important personal data. He has it recorded in his system. In fact, the other day I came across one solution provider who is telling lifetime free, when you enter my society, if you install it in the society premises, lifetime free I will give you. You can, you know, you just take a selfie on your photo, you tell out your name, or you type out your name, you type out your mobile number, and there's no need for any watchman to do anything. And it's lifetime free for the society. Very lucrative. What is their purpose? How are they giving it like lifetime free? They have all access to all your data. Sab mil gaya na, photo bhi mil gaya, face recognition ke liye. Mobile number to mil hi gaya, naam bhi mil gaya hai. Maybe they'll ask you to put the Aadhaar number also next, or any other personal identifier. So we have to be aware as to where the pitfalls are. We have to orient ourselves also. The entire ecosystem has to be aware that how data privacy will play out. FinSec 24 will deliberate on these implementation channels that the organizations are facing in data governance, data protection, and data management in the light of the DPDP Act. I also understand there is an inaugural innovation arcade and a startup exhibition providing a platform to the startups in the field of cybersecurity. I congratulate DSCI and Mr. Vinayak on this sixth edition of the FinSec 24. And I wish that FinSec 24 will have free and candid deliberations. It will explore the partnerships between the various private-private, public-private, and such other combinations, and empower the stakeholders to better combat the threat of cybersecurity risks. So I wish you all a very good 2 days ahead, and think you're working for the country, to save the country, and to save the financial services sector. Thank you. Thank you for a patient listening.
Well, I must say some phenomenal thoughts flowing in the room right now. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your address. And we're truly humbled to have you here today. Again, a big round of applause for Ms. Day. And I now request Mr. Godse to felicitate Ms. Day with a token of appreciation. Well, I'm sure that your value, ma'am, has added a lot of value to this conclave. A round of applause one more time.